Welcome to our meeting. Today is Saturday, July 29, 2023, and our topic is artificial intelligence and how we're working with it to solve biological aging. Big thanks to Miles Jacobs. Miles makes these meetings happen. AI is of great importance in our future for biological age management and reversal. Today, I'll talk about what we're doing, and then we'll hear about what some others are doing in some of their projects. Then there'll be a couple of other topics and some open discussion. Krishna Arukata is a highly talented AI and software developer. I have the good fortune to be working with Krishna. And actually, he's the brains behind all this. After I show you some things, Krishna may chime in and briefly describe some of the technical aspects of our projects. So it's important to stress that what you're going to see today, what I'm going to talk about, we are in the early exploratory stages, and it's a long, long road ahead. We have been immersing in this for about the last several weeks and making very good progress. And the power of these systems is really going to be pretty great for advancing biological age reversal and helping keep us young and healthful, of course, for a very, very long time. I'm going for open-ended lifespan. And then after that, well, we have a lot of other projects to make the world a much better place. The plan now is to develop multiple kinds of apps, and I'll show you what they are. Each of these apps will do different things, although we're focusing on one AI system right now. We're in learning about this frontier. I've found that there are some other outstanding apps out there doing much the same thing. When the time is right, we would like to work with these other groups and perhaps implement their systems in our system, maybe, as what's called an API, an application programmer interface, where the two systems kind of work together, or one system uses the core processing of the other system, but we'll see how that goes. Well, the first one, I will show you an overview of the projects we're working on now. These were some simple ideas to start at the top, but let's start with what we're working on right now. Well, okay, of course, you know, the ultimate question and solution we need is to solve the problems of biological aging so we can be young. That's kind of broad for today's AI. If you know of a system that exists somewhere to just ask it that question, how can we be young again? And it'll give us an answer personalized to us because we're all different. I'd like to know about it. But so we're working on first narrowing it down, and the overriding idea: review massive amounts of medical literature and other information and draw conclusions and create solutions. So the main one we're working on, and we have a working prototype for this now that's coming along thanks to Krishna's outstanding expertise and work, is a system where members, you will be able to enter your questions for the AI to answer. And some of the questions you've sent to me, which I'm going to show next, are very creative, very useful for it to answer. So the AI would answer the question for you. And all questions and answers would be stored in a database. And then later, another more powerful AI program to be developed will ingest and analyze all previous questions and answers and give us even more information. that is what we are working on right now. Next in line is biomarker analysis, both personalized and aggregate. So we would, and we've only begun thinking about how this would operate, but we would upload lab reports and other information to the system and train the system on how to analyze these, and it would come back with information about how our system, how it's all working and what we can do to improve our therapies and our program. Okay, later, this one will get rather specialized, DNA analysis, both personalized and aggregate. And you may recall from our previous meetings that one of the initiatives that's really the number one is, to my mind, is gene therapy and gene editing. Further down the line, when we have the technology, I'm looking to have personalized analysis of an individual's, of your DNA, to determine what gene therapies would be right and best for you, in addition to those that would be proven to be beneficial for everyone, or virtually everyone. So that's coming down the line. We'll need some specialized genomic analysis for that. There is a powerful system I use called an MFIT. It consists of a processor, and it's an online system, but there's a little strip that goes under your bed at night. And sleep data can be very useful and very powerful in evaluating not only your health, but before and after a new therapy. For example, Steve Perry is very knowledgeable in this. I've used this with my GDF-11 and Clotho therapy injections. And these are just some samples. It's a really robust system, multiple parameters. This was my sleep score for one night. This is the heart rate variability. This is the screen for heart rate is on the top. Heart rate variability at 15-minute intervals throughout the night. This is my trend. I was trending upward. It's a very valuable tool. You may consider it for your own health program. And then a completely different category to be addressed soon is new aging therapy development with the help of AI. J.J. Ben-Joseph is a very knowledgeable guy I met at the Foresight Conference in San Francisco, and he's working on it. And of course, Alex Zvronkov and InSilico and some others are working on that. So far, any questions at this point?
Yeah, I have a question.
Go ahead.
AIs need to be trained, and they need to be trained on data sets. And if they're not properly trained, they begin to tell lies and make things up and give you references that don't exist. So I was wondering how the AIs you're talking about are properly trained.
Well, okay. Right now, our system, and I'm just going to briefly touch on this, and I'm going to show you something in our application that's relevant to this. That's another thing that's kind of related to that. The system is now at a point where it's using AutoGPT. Krishna, if he chooses to talk a little bit later, can give you a better explanation, but it's using the GPT. Ours is now using the GPT 3.5 system. Why isn't it using 4.0, you might ask? Well, we tried to get it. It will be available to us in several weeks. I've had an OpenAI account for at least a month, maybe 2 months, but it's just not available to us yet. But our system, and Krishna is working on this right now, is going to use a browser. And I've heard the term free range used. I think Pete Cooperrider mentioned that word. But as the name implies, it goes out to current information on the internet. And maybe Krishna will tell you about how he's going to do that, but he should have that component of it done this week. But I haven't, I'll get to that a little more when I actually show you the system. These are some questions. Our current system, which looks and feels kind of like ChatGPT and some others. So you can probably read these yourself. And I've learned that the way you phrase these is important. We've been moving so fast, developing so much, that it seems like our system doesn't quite process S's that are in parentheses like that. So I'll take that out later. But okay, here's a broad overreaching question. Find, analyze, and comment on scientific papers about multimodal. You can read that yourself. Just addressing biological aging processes. Okay. Then narrowing it down a little bit, asking specifically about lithium. Here's another one. Research everything on PubMed on rapamycin. Basically, to what's the best protocol? Obviously, with a browser system, this would have access to a paper that was published just minutes ago. I do not know how long it takes to train a system, but I understand it's kind of a big deal. So this system will have that advantage, or that's the plan. So here's more plasma gene therapy. Yeah, I'm kind of keen on plasmid or mini-circle gene therapy in addition to other vectors. This is a new one. Yeah, you can probably read these, but here it's getting into personalized medicine where we would feed it. And this is like the next generation, I think, but where it would be fed a personal data spreadsheet, and then it would also search out research literature to come up with solutions for that person's medical condition. So moving right along, these may seem familiar to you. This is one that I think Jabba sent this in. How much does changes in stem cell rate reflect the biological age? Which human tissues have been successfully de-aged or revitalized? And what are the challenges? And so forth. I'll just let you read through that. These were all sent to GRG. There's nothing proprietary here. Other AI apps. I want to keep you fully informed. AutoGPT Local, this one, AskLongevityGPT.com. Very impressive. And it gives you the papers it's referencing too. This is the thing about the private chat bot. Elicit, E-L-I-C-I-T, Consensus, God Mode, and ChatGPT, and chatbase.co. This is the internal setup of our app. It's called a prompt, and it is similar in some ways in that we are instructing the system to narrow it down as to what we're looking for. I've tried this two ways, and the one that, actually I've tried it several ways, but I compared the output of two, and what I have at this stage gives superior results to the one before it. So this is going to be, I believe, a constantly refined process, but you give it these instructions, first a description, an overview, and the system understands this, it's natural language, and then tells it more about what it is, what its responsibilities, ultimate goal, empower users with knowledge and facilitate very long, healthy life leading to open-ended healthy life in humans. So then it goes down and gives some more details. So I thought you might find that interesting, important component. Here is our actual system. You'll see the output here, but basically, this is where we'll enter a question and we'll get the answer up here. Krishna just implemented something very useful and important called memory, where it will display the first answer to the first question in the output screen. And then if you ask it a supplement question or questions, it will refer back to the information in the previous questions and answers. We're in the early stage. It is really fortunate that we have anything to show today, and we're improving it. Krishna expects that sometime this week we should have the browser version of this. It would be a big step forward. Also, when version 4.0 is available to us, that should be an exponentially better.
So, Johnny, just to follow up on that previous question. So what is AutoGPT versus ChatGPT? Is AutoGPT just an API version of ChatGPT, or what is that?
That would be a Krishna question.
Hi, everybody. So AutoGPT is kind of an automated agent. It uses ChatGPT as backend. So we have to define some goals for that agent, like, let's say we have to do some research on longevity. We have to set up some goals for AutoGPT so that it can go through web, or it can do its own research and it will put some results in front of us. That is AutoGPT. So ChatGPT is different from AutoGPT. So AutoGPT uses GPT 3.5 model to accomplish our tasks.
So it has the same knowledge base as ChatGPT 3.5. Is that correct to assume?
Yes, it's a knowledge based.
Right. But when you say it can go on the web, and so what do you, just trying to figure out your software architecture here?
Yeah, there are some developers built this AutoGPT. They have made some contributions to the AutoGPT project, and they have made some applications in such a way that it can able to browse our internet to pull latest information regarding the question that user asked, where in right now ChatGPT can't able to access internet, right? Okay. So they have provided that internet browsing feature for AutoGPT. So it's kind of an automated agent where we can define some tasks to do some research or anything of sort of research or anything else. So to accomplish our own tasks.
Does it look up scientific papers or just?
Yes, it can do. Yeah, me and Johnny has already tested. It can able to look for public websites like PubMed or anything similar to that. It can able to pull out latest recent researches available on longevity, anti-aging, age reversal.
And can I ask it to like pull up all the papers, let's say on plasmapheresis, and read them?
Yes, it can do that. It has that ability.
And then list them for me and read them and see if there is an answer to this or that question in any of these papers.
Yes, it can able to do that. Right now, it can just put some information that we have asked for, but later we can make that information to get the answer we want.
You know, because that would be enormously valuable, because, right, I mean, the human being can't go, it takes forever to go read all these papers, but if your tool can do that, and then see if the answer is in any of them, and if we can trust it, that's a pretty big thing.
Yes. Right now, it's a heavy application to run. So right now, developers are working to make it light and make it available for public. So there are some websites that can provide AutoGPT ability, like Godmode.space. There is one website. I heard Agent GPT. That is one. So there you can test AutoGPT.
Okay, there are some good questions and comments coming in the chat. I will forward that to those to GRG.
John, I wanted to mention something too real quick.
Yeah.
Just for clarity, so ChatGPT can connect to the internet. There is a plugin, and you can use that plugin to have it search everything up to September 2021. You can specify with different plugins to read, to give you certain information, you can give it that. The key differentiator between AutoGPT and ChatGPT is AutoGPT can actually execute, several tasks simultaneously, sort of in parallel. So it may do one thing and then it may do another and it may go back and forth, where ChatGPT generally doesn't do that, except sometimes it will. It depends on what tool you're using sort of within there. And this is all publicly available in the Plus version, $20 a month. Some of them you do have to apply like for their beta tool, and it takes a little time. But it's definitely a very powerful tool. And I'll show the code interpreter later after this as well.
Next up is to make it browser mode, browse the internet. And then when the time is right, we'll put it up on the internet for everyone to use and evaluate. We'll call it a beta or maybe an alpha, but also the function using a vector database, which is the new kind of database with many advantages that AIs like to use. It will save the questions and answers for future analysis. And then finally, when the time is right, maybe now, we can, Christian and I can team with some of you to build just the greatest system to solve biological aging. And in 100 years, we can talk about what we did back in 2023. Okay, so Anton?
After the ChatGPT became famous, of course, everybody wanted to try how to apply it for their use cases. And I believe in early spring, my collaborator Nikhil Yadala, who is not here, so he noticed an obvious problem that ChatGPT, by that time, it even couldn't access internet. And it also had problems that it had no up-to-date scientific knowledge of aging. And when you asked it to give sources, it gave fake sources. So it started in the beginning of spring. So what Nikhil did, he got ChatGPT API, and he also wrote some code that interacted with Semantic Scholar. So Semantic Scholar is an initiative by Allen Institute of AI to actually provide access to scientific literature with APIs. And for example, let me type, you see my screen, right? Let me type, for example, metformin versus rapamycin for aging. So what it will do, it will make requests to Semantic Scholar API to get information on papers that takes a bit of time. Then it will vectorize these papers to the format when you can do similarity vector search, and it will provide the answer with direct quotes that are actually real quotes and not something made up. So the downside of current system is that you see it doesn't have a big index of itself, so you have to wait until it fetches the data. But you see in the response that actually it has passages and specific even pages from which it took information. So the answer, it may not look super spectacular, but at least you can check exactly where it took off, because the problem with ChatGPT, it can give, like, you read the answer, it like sounds super cool, but then you realize that part of it is made up. So later, in the beginning of May, what happened is Zuzalo happened. It is an initiative by Vitalik Buterin, VitaDAO, and many others to prototype a network state for longevity, crypto, AI, and so on. And we had a hackathon there. And actually, one of the projects that I was doing it was addressing the problems with LLMs and actually extending longevity GPT with additional things. So here, for example, you see on the slide so in our case, we were curious because one of the things that me and I think Maria Koval is also at this call. So one of the things that we are doing is just DNA-seq personalized longevity genomics project. And we wanted to know how ChatGPT-4 answers the questions. And you can see that a simple check shows that at least one of the sources is fake. And also sometimes it confuses like which allele you have. So it can kind of give a reasonable answer, but then you realize that it confused your alleles, and it's kind of sometimes scary what it can give to you. And what we wanted, so in case of Nick Hill, he just made queries to paper sources, and we were curious if we can integrate it with different structured data. And as a prototype, we took data from our genomic report, so it can query gene variants that you can find in the report. So here, for example, a query was made for this variants of in my genome that you see highlighted. And for ChatGPT, you can see like it's most of the answer was actually useless. So if you just ChatGPT, like red is useless, orange is just general info. And only part of it was actually nothing was really specific. So we also did check on longevity GPT, and there were some specific stuff, but not very detailed because it's papers, it's not structural information. So we did like our system, we also had like Telegram interface, and we put the data that we had in our genetic databases to vectorized form and to feed it to the large language model. So a simple terminology, the thing that I'm telling is called in-context learning. So the idea of in-context learning is that each large language models, it has is a context, some number of words, usually they call it tokens, that it keeps in memory, like your chat. And it's limited how much it can process. For ChatGPT-4, it's 8,000, for example. So you, what you do, you actually augment the question by the user with what you see, for example, in references here. And the way how you search for the data is with vector form that will allow actually better search than text-based search. So you take any model, can be ChatGPT, can be Llama, can be Beluga, And you just have a system that augments, it's called retriever augmented generation with information. And that means that you have ChatGPT plus domain specific data. So here you see that actually for some of the queries, we got really specific answers with sources. And because it was database, it was somewhat better with Nikhil. Also, actually, we started coding like integration, like you can have multiple sources, can have databases, can have papers from GPT. And there was a second round of hackathon. And there we were actually curious on another aspect. It's called agents. So AutoGPT actually is the one that you talked before is an agent. Agent means that it's a large language model powered systems that can have some internal thoughts and it can have actions. Like you can tell it to when, like for example, when it says, I want to use this function, it can you can let it access and call different programming functions to actually interact with the world. And with agents, here is actually a picture from our prototype with an agent. We made an agent for a clinical trial database. And as a prototype, you could, for example, say, find explanations of why the first in the list cancer drug trial. We started not so you can like with a normal text, you can make a serious query to the database here. And on the right, you here see a terminal how actually agents. So agent is the way actually is the you tweak, you give large language models instructions and you can make multiple calls that it have things like thoughts, actions, and observations. Thoughts is like its internal planning, what is required to be done. Actions is that what it says it should do, like call this function or that function. So you can capture the section and execute the code that it generates. And observation is the retrieval of this code. And when it thinks that observations is enough to have a good answer, it gives the answer with appropriate observation. And we also had another example with the clinical trials. And this is core idea is that, and actually what we are working on, that we want like a Swiss knife. We want to provide the large language models, agents, vectorized data sources, and other means to augmented with aging related data. Now we are also thinking about parameter efficient fine tuning. So few words actually, because there were questions about this. So the way how you, so if we talk about models with, for example, ChatGPT, because it's proprietary, you can only provide the like in context learning, so like to retrieve additional data and put it to context, and you can like use some tricks like memory with vector databases, but it's pretty limited. You cannot really train it because it's super large and it's proprietary. So it's mostly like you call it, you give it additional context data, you get results. With smaller models, like for example, Llama 2 or Stable Beluga, you actually can do training. It's called fine tuning. We are now thinking about experimenting with, so when you train, you can get better results than with like in context learning, because it's actually explores the data. There are tricks like quantization, like adapters, like LoRa that actually can make it even cost efficient. But it's something we plan to experiment soon. We are not on it. So far, we are mostly providing additional sources and indexing literature. So far, I downloaded full archive of Semantic Scholar, because currently the reason why sometimes longevity GPT falls short is because the way to query Semantic Scholar API is limited to 100 papers, and sometimes it gives bad answers because it's not likely to get enough papers to search data there. And I have several hundreds gigabytes of papers data that I'm planning to put to vectorized storage. And for actually vector databases, here is an illustration. The idea is that machine learning models, they learn representation of the world. That means like with the meaning. So see out here on the picture, you can see that, for example, animals are closer together, bananas and apples are closer together. So sometimes the user can have very different wording for what, like, for example, lifespan, life extension, rejuvenation, and so on. It's different words, but they have very close meanings. That means that when you use vectorization of the query and you have vector databases, you can do similarity search and get not only what is mentioned directly as a part of the text query. And yeah, so here's some people who participated in the hackathon. Now we are continuing it. Maria, are you still here? So for example, Maria is now working on an agent that can query a GNH database and answer about longevity interventions on animals. Maria, are you here? Or at the LA meeting already? I think she left for ILA meeting. Yeah, so that's what we are doing. We have GitHub organization. We have also several people working on it. Everything is open source, and it's a lot of work because there are many information sources to process. You have to write like an agent for each of it. That's it on my side.
Yeah, wow, that's amazing work. Anton, you mentioned several times vectorized databases. Can you elaborate on what that means and who does that vectorization?
Maybe I can share again part. So my first desktop. Here, you see this like some multidimensional space, you see like with cats, dogs, bananas, and so on. So the idea is that when you teach a machine learning model, after some time, it organizes. So when you teach it, you have the way how it works. It uses tokenization, so splitting the sentence, it's by tokens, usually it's words, but not always. And then it, when you train it, it changes its weights and it reorganizes. So each word is like a vector in a multidimensional space. Here you can see like a dot in three-dimensional space. In fact, it's way more like way more dimensions than like billions of dimensions. But the thing is, after training, you get things that are similar and that it learned from training that are similar, often together, they get closer. And when you transform text into this kind of vector representation, it's called embeddings. And you can, for example, if you want to, you have scientific, but actually one of the things that I'm doing, I am getting research papers. I am running this function to transform text into those vectors. And I am putting it to databases that are efficient into storing them. And they can do similarity search. So not like, for example, when we search for text, usually it's like exact match, like a word. And here you can say, I want this word and everything that is connected. So when you, for example, search for lifespan extension, it can also look into results of health span extensions if because health span is pretty close to it. And before that we used Chroma database, and now we are thinking about Quadrant. And also for Johnny's and Krishna project, I don't know which vector database they're using, but the technology stack is pretty similar, I think.
Well, there's a lot to learn. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. That is amazing. How can we stay, Anton, how can we stay informed about your work? Is there a mailing list?
So far, we mostly, so we have a kind of a Telegram chat where we coordinate. Also, we have a GitHub organization. So right now, actually, like we had to put it down some of the stuff that we did for the hackathon because we are rewriting the code. The code in hackathon actually is pretty ugly. But there is this GitHub organization, and yeah, so feel free to contact me. Also, if anybody wants, I can add you to the Telegram chat. What can be useful is several things. One thing is because there are many data sources, if you can take some data source, can be like some database or some other type of source. So the idea is that we can separately have agents dealing with, for example, Ensemble, GNH, NH, DragH, and so on. And I can explain people how to write those agents. And if people want to volunteer, they can make their own agents to work with those databases. And the last thing, we may need some, when we will start experimenting with parameter efficient fine tuning, we may need some GPU power. So we will be working with Llama 2 based models, and we may need some GPU for this. Some technically GPU credits or something like this. If any of you go to ARDD conference in Copenhagen in the end of August, we will present our progress in more detail there.
Amazing, thank you. We'll definitely be in touch.
Because I will have to go to International Longevity Alliance meeting now.
Very good.
So I can take a question or two.
Okay. I believe Anton has a couple minutes for questions. Any more questions?
In the chat, someone asked whether that meeting he's going to is open.
Oh, ARDD?
No.
The Telegram link, I can give it, but also most of the things there is technical discussions, so just be ready for this. Give me a sec, I will share the link. Where is this group link? I gave a link, but be ready that it will be a lot of technical stuff.
Anton, what language is it implemented in? Computer language.
Right now, it's just Python. It's we are using LangChain. It's so there are like several popular libraries, LangChain, and there is also Lambda Index. So far, we are using LangChain mostly. Also, AltaGPT is pretty popular, the one that Krishna is using.
Yeah. So good prototyping languages.
No, it's Python. It's Python, just library called LangChain that does orchestration between vector databases, prompts, large language models, and so on. And as a database, we are moving to Quadrant right now.
Thank you.
Can you plug into the Telegram as well?
And were you going to put a link in the chat, Anton?
I accidentally answered the personal message, meeting group chat. This is Telegram, and the GitHub organization is here. And for Longevity GPT, here is the link.
Thank you.
Yeah. I see the Telegram link now.
Oh, and if anyone is interested in forming an AI special interest group where we just meet separately, let me know, we'll make it happen.
Actually, one of the things that I forgot to say, that actually collecting queries that we can ask and thinking, for example, what we did when hackathon happened is that we asked a bunch of people to get queries to Longevity GPT, and we had comparisons like ChatGPT with nothing, Longevity GPT, and we implemented some port, how much the answer will be better with calling some specific agents. It's not a bottleneck, but in the future, such kind of questions will be useful, as well as those who have some expertise in aging. Also, if you have some ideas how it can be answered better, like with which knowledge or how to improve, such feedback will be useful.
Well, I'll volunteer to help in any way I can. So, okay. And I've been collecting questions. I'll send them to you. All right. It's getting quite late for Vincenzo. He's in Italy. And if there are no more questions for Anton, and Anton, wow, that was outstanding, amazing, amazing work. Vincenzo, are you still here?
Yes, I'm here. Thank you, Anton, for your amazing work. I can be more short in my presentation, and I can directly share to go ahead. So. Okay, can you see my browser now?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So what we did, we like I was working on the Open Cures app for years now. Basically what it is, I switched to a tab. It's a biomarker dashboard for individuals. You can improve your lab data, like blood work, or also from variables like the MFIT and sleep analysis. Or from the Oura Ring, Apple Watch, whatever. Graph the data and share it also in experiments with others. What I did here, like what we have here is a database with ranges and a personalized ranges engine, I call it, which means that it scans the data and gives you your evaluated ranges. Not as like a table, like you would find it on the LabCorp website, for example, because it depends on age, gender, ethnicity, and various other factors. And we have an engine that gives the range for your demographics. So when you use this app, it's free of charge. You can use it. You get you set up first a profile with your age, gender, ethnicity, skin type, all these demographics and phenotypes, and then it can do that. What I experimented with ChatGPT, the ChatGPT API, is that I prompted it similar to what Johnny did, but I additionally give the system the out-of-range biomarkers. In this case, if you can see, ALT, APO, lipoprotein, et cetera, these biomarkers and the demographics and what is your age and gender, et cetera. So more detailed information about your profile. And there is an echo. And I have a chat interface built in here, and it's a one button solution. So you just click here, interpret my results. I have done it now because it takes some time to load. I don't want you to wait. And this is what it gets you back. So I, in the system prompt, just a little more specifically, I ask it to give me a summary, like an executive summary. What does it mean? What are the potential risks if I do nothing? What are the potential causes that causes these biomarkers to be out of range? And give me some potential interventions in a list and rank them by potential impact. And also be more specific about the schedule, the dosage, and prioritize the dimension that I should take. So similar to like the workflow a health coach or a health professional would do for you. With the goal to automate that. It was an experiment. I make it a little bit bigger. Maybe now you can read it better. What I learned from that experiment, many points Anton did touch very well. Here it just uses ChatGPT. So it just uses the internal knowledge from the trained data from ChatGPT, which is, for example, the scraped data from the internet. And this is also one downside. So the answer is very like basic. So if you read a lot of these WebMD or headline or like these public blog posts, this is the kind of information you get out of that system directly if you use it directly. Basically tells you eat well, move sufficiently, don't have a sedentary lifestyle, like this kind of basic interventions. And the supplements are very basic. For example, here, manage your stress. You need a lot of physical exercise. Try an elimination diet. I mean, these are basics that work for everyone essentially and are safe to basically tell all the people. So it's not very specific. This could be one potential for AutoGPT. Maybe I try my take how to explain it in easy terms. AutoGPT is just a software wrapper around ChatGPT. It uses ChatGPT, but it prompts itself again and again and again, which is similar of what you would do with ChatGPT. For example, you ask a very broad question, what should I do? And then you ask it again, okay, I am a male, I am 36, what should I do? And then you ask it again, okay, I have some conditions, what should I do? And then it gets more detailed in the answers, and it asks itself, okay, is this fact correct? And then it searches the internet and then it refines the answer until it thinks it finishes the goal. So that's kind of the potential, which would also increase the accuracy of this kind of answer. So this is kind of what I learned. I think ChatGPT or like AutoGPT, we shouldn't use it to query this kind of information. What it's really good for is to understand questions in like natural language and act on that. So what we now use it for, not for this kind of use cases, hey, read, search me papers, read them, summarize them. That yes, but not for direct questions like, okay, what's the perfect dosage for rapamycin for my case? That's too special. So what I think the future is here is that the LLM technology, like ChatGPT, should be kind of the understanding mechanism and the controller kind of thing to operate on different databases, data sets, and functionalities to actually automate the workflows that a health professional would do, or like help a health professional to work faster, to be more productive. To then get to the goal where you actually want to go, which is getting the right schedule, the right dosage for your specific case, or the specific intervention, what you should do essentially. And this is what we are working on. So basically have the ChatGPT be the controller and the helper to interact with user interface, with databases, and with your data to help you on your health journey to get to that goal, so that you get to the precise information that you need. Yeah. So that's kind of my summary. I think, yeah, ask anything.
So I trust you must be an OpenOM member or subscriber to use this system.
It's login based, but it's free of charge, yes.
Okay. So how do you sign up for that?
Just go to our website, opencurious.org. Here I explain it more in detail what the platform is all about. There's also a video. And just click on launch. That's it. Here you can log in.
Okay. So the steps are to first fill out a brief intake form or questionnaire with some health information, and then it can upload automatically lab reports and answer a few other questions. And then the AI is there and it will do on your data what you showed us. Did I get that right? Or what did I leave out?
Yeah, that's sounds pretty okay. Good. So it's more of a automation helper around. If you would take all your lab reports and put that into ChatGPT, so it helps you around that process.
Outstanding.
And is this a company? What is OpenCures?
Yes, it's a company. It's founded by Kevin Perrin from California, and I co-founded with him the software part.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting.
Well, amazing work, Vincenzo. Again, you get a big round of applause too.
Thank you.
Jason? You're up if you choose to accept.
Yes, and a very good job, Vincenzo. Appreciate that. Give me one second. First, I'll give a little short intro, about what we're doing. So, in general, the speed of change of technology is really so fast now. These new tools that we're seeing today and on a day-to-day basis are evolving so quickly that most people, as we know, can barely keep up with everything. There's becoming, to some degree, more intelligent than humans on some measurements. The other day I was talking to ChatGPT and I just realized this is an incredible system. It's obviously taken years to put together, but this is one of the most powerful tools that I've seen. And we're still really just at the beginning of seeing its capability and what it could do for our underlying mission to accelerate our path towards age-reversal technology. The thing about ChatGPT that I noticed is it really gets it when you ask it something the mass majority of the time, versus if you're talking to something like Siri or Alexa. It really doesn't know what you're talking about. And it's just a drastic difference that I've seen. And with respect to autonomous agents, those will have their time. I don't think they're quite there yet. They're still in development, but they will be even more powerful because they'll be able to make split-second decisions and put together different things that we can't really do as humans. So I'll go through a few demonstrations today. First, just the overall platform for ChatGPT. Under the hood is GPT-4, which is the latest version that OpenAI has released. And eventually they will have GPT-5 driving as the underlying engine to the next version of ChatGPT, and that'll be dramatically better as well. So there's a couple of things. One, if you want to use the current version, you do have to pay money to OpenAI. It does cost $20 a month. I think it's a great investment, in my opinion. Two, to see your actual settings, so you go over here. There's three areas on the platform. If you go to settings and beta, for example, you can go to beta features. And this is where you can actually turn on your custom instructions, your plugins, and your code interpreter. You may not see these on your platform when you go through them, but if you don't, you have to sometimes go on their website and essentially apply to their beta version. Maybe they'll ask you a question or two, like why you want to use it, and you basically just tell them, and that's about it. And then that's pretty much it on the beta features. You know, those are the main ones. Plugins, there's going to be a lot of plugins that exist today, such as accessing the internet and reading papers. And then you have the custom instructions, which are really different things that customize the response to what you want. So, you know, if you're talking to something like ChatGPT, you know, let's say it's in some form of an intelligent agent or an intelligent system, let's say, and you can give it instructions. So for example, here, I have custom instructions that I say, it says, what would you like ChatGPT to know about to provide you better responses? Say, we focus on age reversal. We are building a business for age reversal. Pretty straightforward. How would you like ChatGPT to respond? You should have opinions with reasoning, fairly short responses. So you could give this anything you want. You know, you could say that you're a musician and you're very into making new music, or you could say to give you responses in the form of poetry, or really you could give it anything you want. You could say to give you responses in the style of Steve Jobs, for example. That way you don't have to prompt engineer the system each time to give you that specific response, because in the past you would have to really tell it what kind of response you want. So I will run a few things in real time, but I just wanted to show, for example, when I asked the question, I believe John Kramer dropped in the chat here about which 5 supplements to take, it gave a response, and it gave kind of a surface level response. But then I just said, can you give me some better ones? And you can see it gave 5 completely different compounds. And, you know, some might say these are better, and, you know, it's always debatable. But just wanted to show that it's really all about how you ask the system its questions to get the response you want. Grab a sip of water. Okay, I'll keep going for a sec, and then I'll stop for questions, but I do want to show the actual system in action as well. I say something like, give me studies on plasmapheresis. And then I say, you know, can you summarize number 1 with bullets? And notice here, it did look up on the internet. It did search for studies. Now, if you misspell something, it'll give you links. Like say I misspell plasmapheresis, it's going to give you links, but those links are going to be linking to the wrong websites. And it doesn't always get it actually on the links part, but it does look up in real time on the internet. It does have access. So for example, when I click on this link here, I open it, it's some study on PubMed about plasmapheresis. So, and then I say something like, you know, can you give me a summary of number 1, and it'll do that. So let's say we wanted to look up maybe a related topic. You know, let's say, can you give me information on, let's say, similar procedures for age reversal? So, you know, it's not always going to get exactly what you want, but usually, you know, I like letting it have some freedom. But really, the more you specify the output you want, the more you actually tell it what you're looking for, the better its response is going to be. If you give it a very open-ended question like this, you know, it's going to give you something, but it might not be quite as useful. But you can see it's going through different age reversal things here. So, you know, now say you're like, okay, well, let me see some studies on gene therapy. You say, okay, I'll say, give me studies on gene therapy, recent ones. So let's see if it can know. So it should know to look up on the web. So it uses the plugin WebPilot, looks up, starts looking things up. So now it's going to try a few things. There's a few other plugins that can look up on like Scholar and a few other websites as well. Give it a sec here. So now it's just printing out sources, links to gene therapy things. So let's see if it got one. So we come over here. Okay. And non-viral vectors in gene therapy. Okay. So this is from 2021. Not bad. Let's say we want to summarize number one. Give me the high level details in bullet format and tell me the insights on how it can slow down my aging. Let's just say. Okay. So now, you know, I'm kind of just having it summarized. Now, obviously, I could go and I could just read that paper, but that's going to take me a lot of time. And, you know, really the way it can summarize information, I find to be very good. It can also give advice if you ask it the right questions. And I find it very useful. So you can see here, you know, it gives sort of the summary, gives a little description about what non-viral vectors are. And then here are the implications. You know, I just came up with this on the spot. You know, what are the implications for slowing down aging? And, you know, obviously you have to take out all this with a grain of salt. Just like a human, the system is going to be wrong sometimes. Sometimes it's going to go in the wrong direction. And that's up to the user to really push it in the right direction and ask the right questions. And know when it is, you know, just like a human, it may be overly confident. It might say, look, this is how it slows down aging. These are the sources. This is the reasoning. And in reality, you read it and it might not be perfect, just like anyone. But you can see here, it says, you know, it's important to note that this is a rapidly evolving field and many of the potential applications of gene therapy for aging are still in experimental stages. Okay. So now say you give it a more, and I do want to go through the code interpreter, but I'm hoping people find this useful. But say you have it read all three of these papers and come to maybe a broader conclusion. Now, this is a more sophisticated task. I mean, let's see what it can do. Can you read all three papers and give me your thoughts on the interrelated conclusions? And here I'll just misspell a word and let's see if it can still understand. Let's see what it can do. Oh, couldn't do that one. So it's not going to be able to get all of them, but let's see if it can. Can you please read them? Sometimes you just got to ask a few times and it'll. This relates to the question someone else was asking about bypassing paywalls. Just wanted to show that there. You know, sometimes it'll say that. But okay, so it's obviously not, you know, it's not gonna be perfect. It's not understanding. Now I could prompt it more and really get the info I want, but I'll move on to the actual code interpreter. So I'll make a new chat here.
Can I get give a note on that?
Yeah, go for it.
This is where the term prompt engineering comes in. So it is kind of a raw tool and there are techniques to get around certain problems. What I do often is when I'm not sure if that is correct, I actually give him the task of, hey, is it really correct what you're saying here? And often it gives you a prompt like, hey, sorry for the confusion. You're right. That fact that you mentioned is not correct. This is the correct fact. And that works pretty well. Yeah, and the challenges for web searching, I found the Bing chat actually be way better. Did you try that out?
What was it? Bing?
Yeah, the Bing chat under the hood works with GPT-4 as well and has internet access.
Okay, I'll try that in a minute here. I want to see, it's doing something. It's doing a few searches here. Okay, so it looks like it re-looked them up. and now it's giving me summaries of all three. So that was a good tip there, Vincenzo, just saying, like, is that really correct? Like, try again, kind of a thing. And a lot of the time it'll get it. Now, here are the interrelated conclusions. Now, I find this useful because, you know, a lot of time we have to give the conclusion ourselves in our mind, but if it can give it for us. For example, here it says the second and third papers both discuss the use of gene therapies for cancer treatment, with a third paper specifically discussing immunotherapy and so on here. Okay, so I can try Bing, Vincenzo, but I wanted to show the code interpreter. Let me see if there's an easy way. I don't even think I have the Bing one, actually.
I mean, in the Bing, in the Edge browser.
Okay, maybe we'll do that after. Maybe we'll come back to that part. Yeah. Just because I'm not as familiar. Okay, we'll do the code interpreter part first. So, all right. So essentially, there's three versions on ChatGPT, and there's the Bing version that Vincenzo's talking about. Code interpreter default, which is the standard, and then plugins. These two are betas. So the code interpreter, I just accessed that one here. And this one you can essentially input and output data. So I'll start with some data from Vincenzo, and thanks for sending this over. I have a few other data sets, but we can start with that one. So I'll just come here and I'll notice I'm just uploading the file here, and now it's uploaded. And I'll say, good afternoon, please. Give me a short summary of this data set. Let's just start with something simple for it. And if anyone has questions about the previous part or this part, feel free to just jump in anytime. Happy to answer them. Okay. So, you know, maybe first what I'll do is let me open up the spreadsheet just to give you an idea of what it looks like very briefly. You know, it has date in this column here, and then it has a bunch of columns with data. And say you're tracking different biomarkers each day, you're tracking your niacin, for example, or you're tracking how much caffeine intake you have and so on. So that's what the data set looks like. And you can see here, it gave me a short summary. Now, if you're a data scientist, you can start giving it very specific commands, but say you're not a data scientist, but you still want to extract some value from this. You know, let's just say, let's do some data science on this, please. So start it with, give it something fairly broad. So now it has these, and it gives you four different options, and I'll just say, let's do all of them. So now, you know, so we'll compute some descriptive statistics and trends and whatnot. Now keep in mind, if you give it a more specific command, like with a very specific output, you're gonna get probably a better result, but sometimes you may not know what you're looking for. Which can be fine too. So yeah, and this data set is an export from the Chronometer diet tracking app. Thanks, Vincenzo, for that. So now it's kind of just doing work. Let's let it do a little more, and then we'll see if we can get it to do some plots, look at things over time. Well, looks like it already started it for me. So let's see here, energy intake over time, alcohol intake over time, caffeine intake, protein intake. So you can see time series of these. And then it starts to go through the correlation of each one. And note that I didn't tell it to do any of that specifically. I just said very broadly, let's do all of them. You know, let's do some data science. So I do like that it does have an element of creativity. That being said, if you get very specific, it, you know, you're going to get a better result. But in the past, keep in mind that a programmer would have to write that code. You have to launch a Jupyter notebook. You have to write Python code to then effectively do some analysis like this. And this is definitely a big shortcut. So let's do a regression analysis and say energy is our y variable. And let's pick the most predictive x variables and use niacin. So let's give it kind of a little bit of a curveball and see if it can handle something like that. Notice too, I wasn't too specific here. I mean, I gave it a little bit of another broad task, and you know, let's see if it can do this. Sometimes it won't be able to; it'll crash. But sometimes it'll give you something interesting and useful. If anyone has like a very specific analysis you would want to do, let me know, and I can do that. But here you see, it basically did a multivariate regression analysis with energy being your thing that you're trying to predict. And it really broke down coefficients on each variable. And, you know, these things might not be that predictive of your energy level, but really just showing this as an example. But maybe though, I mean, think about, look, the coefficient on alcohol, very high. So maybe that gives you a, yeah, it's interesting to think about these outputs a little bit. Let me pause for a sec. Anyone have any questions? Good.
I'm thinking maybe ask it, do I have more energy with niacin or when taking niacin? Something like that.
That's a good question. Let's try that.
Or do these biomarkers indicate I'm in a better state of health than niacin? And then a third one, calculate phenotypic ages on these dates, specifically like Levine-Horvath phenotypic age. That information is out there on the internet, but can this thing figure out how to do it and calculate it here?
Probably not in this case, but let's see. The thing is that the code interpreter is a different version versus the plugin that had access to the internet, and haven't seen a way to combine that, but it should be able to. That being said, it kind of broke down what your phenotypic age biomarkers would use, such as, you know, C-reactive protein, creatine, albumin, and so on, which those aren't in this data set. So wouldn't be able to do that exactly. But good question though, Johnny. Yeah. Let's look at another data set. So let me slide this one in here. This one has some, well, I'll just ask it to you. I'll say, give me a summary of this data set. So these are some longevity genes. So here it gives me the variables. Different genes, different variants, and whether they're significant and non-significant. So let's say, let's use that to gain insight on the genes. So let's see if we give it a broad question, what it can come up with. You can see it, we gave it 280 unique genes. And then it tells me how many instances of each one, such as APOE, 24 instances, and so on. I'll show what this data set looks like here. Let's give you an idea. So you have association, population, variant, and gene. So let's look at the association of the genes. So you can just kind of see the way you interact with it. Obviously, the better questions you give it and, you know, the better responses you're going to get. But it gives you a quick breakdown. It gives you the ability to quickly interact with files. Not only that, but it can output files as well. So say after you do your analysis, you can say, well, give me that spreadsheet that then has that information. So I'll just say visualize. Visuals, please. Let's get it. I always like visuals, so. You can see it broke down different things here. Okay, so this is what I like seeing more. You can kind of break down, you know, here are all the counts on these different genes in this particular data set, which ones are significant and non-significant. Those are the main features I wanted to show, just essentially just showing the ability to interact with websites and the ability to interact with spreadsheets. And then you can always say like, give me an output spreadsheet, that has a subset of the original data, but average across all columns, let's just say. So this is something that, you know, you could do with programming. You could even do that in Excel. You could just take the average of each column. But let's see if it knows. This is a hard question too, because I'm just saying original data. Does it know I'm talking about the original spreadsheet? Let's see if it can do it. And then I'll pass it back to you in a minute here, John. Okay, so. Well, it gave me something. It gave me gene means. And let's see what it looks like. Okay, well, it averaged the wrong ones, the wrong spreadsheet. Let's say from the first spreadsheet, please. Let's see what was the name of that one. Daily summary. Let me just pass it here. Give me averages of this, of each column, and output it to a CSV.
A quick note on that procedure. Oftentimes, it's better to just start a new chat, because it takes all the previous conversation as context in this case, and that could have been created that issue.
Yeah. No, it's a good point because I was being a little vague with it. I was saying just the original data, which anyone would have probably got a little confused. So I definitely agree. But okay, so it looks like it did output column means. And it does look like just opening up the spreadsheet it just made. So these, if you remember our original data set, what it looked like, I'll show it once more here. Here are these, each column representing some time series of biomarkers over time, like urinalysin, for example. And so I just had it give me averages of each one across each column. So you can see like your average alcohol, or your average niacin or B12 and so on. Now obviously someone could take this file and come here in Excel and just take an average, or they could take this file and put it into Python and compute that. But the thing with ChatGPT is just with your verbal, you know, written language. And that's what makes, in my mind, this tool so disruptive and so powerful. So let me pause. Any questions? Oh, you got a comment?
Jason, could you just quickly run in the Excel file, run a averaging yourself on, for example, energy, just to compare the two values?
Sure. Yeah. Let's see if it got it right.
Let's see how accurate it was.
Okay, so 2489. Let's see the other spreadsheet now. Nope, not that one. Yeah, it looks like it got it right. So here's 2489.32. Nice. And in the one we just calculated, apologies, I have tons of 2489.32. So it's the same number. Yep. So it does look like it computed it correctly.
Well, wow.
Any questions? Oh, go ahead. What did you say, Johnny?
Just wow. Yeah, any last questions?
No? I would make a comment on the code interpreter. How I learned it, it is kind of an agent itself because it reasons, writes code to execute and then does execute and even goes ahead and correct on its own. So it is, how I see it, the best agent as for now, like better than OpenGPT, for example.
I agree. It's definitely really good.
Yeah.
Cool. And if anyone has any future questions about it, feel free to reach out anytime. Definitely. And thanks, Johnny. And
thank you. Okay. Again, another standing ovation for Jason. It's been a couple hours, so I'm going to wrap up the meeting and the recording now. And again, remind everyone today is July 29th, 2023. We'll look back on this in a month, a year, 5 years, 10 years, maybe longer. And it will be interesting to see what we were doing today and the state of the technology in years to come. Go to agingintervention.org. And if you are interested in solving the problem of biological aging, then my interest is going all the way, open-ended, healthy life, and making the world a better place, contact me. We'll figure out how we can work together. I'm particularly interested, of course, in AI, as well as gene therapy and resetting the epigenome towards youth or cellular reprogramming. With that, I will wrap up the recording for now. Thanks for joining.